Welcome to Bolivia, the setting for Tom Clancy's Ghost Recon Wildlands. So, this is going to be me talking over footage of the first three missions from the closed beta. There's a couple more after this, and unfortunately I'm not going to have any footage of the multiplayer sections of the game, just because, frankly, I realized too late that, you know, I could do that.
Let's move.
So what we're looking at here is the introduction to the game. Your first three missions, you're dropped into Bolivia as part of the Ghost Recon unit, and it's you and your squad of three guys. They're the little blue dots behind me on the minimap there, and we're going to be trying to find out where a high value target is, a member of one of the resistance cells. So as you can see, standard Ghost Recon, you've got your third person, you've got your first person aiming and movement, squad commands. It's kind of a squad based game, much in the vein of the earlier Ghost Recon, maybe Advanced Warfighter or Rainbow Six, or my personal sort of think notes for that. So Conflict Desert Storm, Republic Commando. And the idea is that you're given freedom to approach any situation and do anything you want. So for right now, what I've decided to do is take a stealthy approach, make my move very carefully, and scope out the area. So that's your menu for giving your squad commands there. Night vision. We have got our binoculars. We can use that to take a look. Unfortunately, I'm at the bottom of a hill and they're at the top of a hill, so binoculars aren't going to work. So what you're going to see here is map, items, there's all your gear, and you have a drone. Now, the drone can do lots of things, but mostly what the drone is for is the idea that you're going to use it to spot and scope out an area before you engage. This is really, really like Rainbow Six Siege's drone in the pre-game setups. So the idea is that you find your targets, you mark them. So that guy sitting over there, I can see him now, and so can everyone. So he's marked on my minimap, and I get a little experience for marking before I kill him. So the game encourages this slow, methodical playstyle by rewarding you for actually doing it. So, a couple more people. You'll notice it doesn't have to be particularly accurate. Got a bit of a range on your drone, and there's a battery down there as well. So, find my target. You can zoom in a bit, see if we can spot him. And obviously, I haven't scoped out the whole area, but you've got a nice bit of space to work with here. So, we have this little nice starting point. You begin with this idea that you're gonna try and find this lieutenant, interrogate him, and basically find out where your target is. Now your target is one of the leaders of the rebel cells. The rebel cell in Bolivia, because as this is a Tom Clancy game, we're looking at a very let's say problematic view of the world. This is me finding a bug, just for hilarity's sake. Again, closed beta, not final. They were very keen to stress that. So what we're looking at here, you've got the team, vehicle interception, tell civilians to give yourself. So the way the game works is you are part of the Ghost Recon team. You have been sent to Bolivia because Bolivia has had a single cartel rise up under a kind of religious cult leader personality. And they have become so powerful and so dangerous that the government has, and I quote, turned a blind eye to their discretions. So what you're looking at is free rein to do whatever you want. Later on you're going to see that the local military forces are in fact part of the enemies for this game. And the idea is that you have been sent in because a DEA agent has been brutally murdered after an attempted assassination, and then proper assassination, at a US embassy. Now, the Americans aren't big fans of this, and they don't really like this idea that this cartel can sell their drugs in, you know, the important bit of America. So they get on with this black ops operation. You don't exist, and you're sent in to basically take apart the entire cartel. Now, it's neat. It actually reminds me a lot of something like Mercenaries, the first one, where you had the deck of cards and you're given the chance to just go and find lieutenants, go and find majors and colonels, and work your way up through the deck of cards till you take out all the bad guys. So, this is me shooting. As you can see, it took me a little while to get used to that. It's the first shot. But you get little bits of experience. The more special stuff you do, like not being detected or not being getting headshots, gets you more experience. Now, sync shot over there. Sync shot is the ability for your team to shoot at the same time you do, and allows for extra stealth. So, right now I need to interrogate this guy. So look around, see, there's a supply box. You tag these and you get extra supplies for rebels. They're used in the upgrading systems. Oh, he spotted me. Oh no. Well, I'm gonna. Oh no, I'm not gonna tackle him. He's gonna lie there, and I can interrogate him. Or, but his friend could notice. No, I can't take him as a human shield. You know, do that. It's not massively good.
Here's the deal, asshole. You answer my questions, or I put a bullet in your gut and leave you to die in your own shit. Lo entiendes?
So as you can see, we get on nicely with the local populace.
You serious? I mean,
clipping problems aside, because my gun is right now inside his head. But the general idea is that you get time to get used to these characters, these lovely, personable people who you're gonna really love at the end of the game.
Amaru's an old man; he's not gonna last long under torture.
They're kind of just assholes.
There's a good chance he's already dead.
Yeah, proper assholes. There's very little redeemable about these characters. They're just kind of unpleasant.
Tango down.
Alright. Yeah, so as you can see, testing things out, got your standard jam effect for weapons damage. So get a nice fallback thing telling you that you're doing it wrong and you should be running away right now. The game does encourage a modicum of tactics, and you'll get a better view of that later on when we try the second part of this mission, which is to go and find Amaru over there. I think anyone who's played The Division will have reasonable level of sort of competence here. It's built in that same playstyle of you've got third person movement, and the idea is that you take aim and kind of take cover, work in first person. It's just not got that back end of experience and the bullet sponge effect of the enemies. Damage is damage. If I shot anyone in the head, they die. That's surprisingly pleasant, actually. Now, this is me testing to see whether or not you can kill the animals. You can! There's llamas in this game. I didn't find them until a lot later. So, you know, secrets and things to look forward to.
Let's get moving.
They're not listening to you. But yeah, so we've got the cartel here. Now, what we're going to do, we've been told the reinforcements incoming. They're not our reinforcements, because we are on our own, as the game is at pains to remind us. We are totally not here on behalf of any government or anything like that. So movement, all that feels really good. The ability to just fall off cliffs and roll, and the climbing's actually kind of responsive and great. Driving is the driving is floaty is probably the best description for it. It's got some problems. You lose control fairly often. You find it a bit difficult. It looks good. It reminds me a little bit of GTA 5 in the sense that you've got Watch Dogs 2, which makes sense. It's probably built on the same engine. But you've got this lovely ability to wander about, bounce off stuff, and I genuinely mean bounce off stuff. You'll see in the next section that I'm just going to start flying across the map in this 4x4. Some vehicles are better suited for off-roading than others. This is one of the better ones. So, trying to get to the game. Reasonably nice water effects. This is all all in the high settings. It's not the most beautiful game I've ever seen, but it's got a nice aesthetic quality. It's fairly well detailed, and what they've done is they put a real effort into the draw distance, so you can see most of the map. That opening shot where you can see the entire valley, that's just what they want. The idea is that, like many of Ubisoft's open world games, you can just go to anywhere you can see. Camera control is decent enough. You do tend to flail a lot in these cars, though. It's fine. You're encouraged to drive or do whatever a lot to get around the place. Things break nicely under you. Except trees. Trees have this habit of not appearing or not existing. So as you can see, we're coming up on the objective. Now, what you might be noticing is that There was also random explosions. Yeah, there's stuff happening all around the map. That, I don't go and investigate what that is, but later on I saw flares and other things, so I imagine that there are rebel forces who are engaging with government forces just around the world, and stuff's happening. So this is the full map. As you can see, there's very little on that map. This is... It's almost a departure for Ubisoft. They've got this thing going on where, rather than the map starting with several million pop-ups for you to go and pick up and explore, you start with question marks to denote landmarks. So for example, we're coming down to a farm. When we get to it, we're going to unlock the landmark for us, and that will show us that the landmark is there and that we know where that location is if we have to come back to it for a mission. But we don't get markers for collectibles, we don't get markers for weapon points, weapon parts, and skill points and that kind of thing. And they're all collectibles you have to go and find. What we do get is those things later. You have to choose to unlock. So this mission is to go and free the captive, but previously we were investigating a lieutenant. That lieutenant, if we had chosen to interrogate him just as part of the game, not part of the mission, we'd be given the option to highlight all of the weapon parts or skill points or missions in this region. Now, there's only one region unlocked for the closed beta, but there are more. There's many more. You're given a huge map, huge, in the full game. So there's a lot going on in terms of things you can look at and just kind of work out from there. So this is a more tactical version of what I was talking about earlier. So we're given a scenario, many enemies, a very clear location to scout out and find. We know where our captive is. We can see that the enemies have different weapons and they've got different equipment and sort of helicopters and the like flying about, sitting about there. Now, what I'm doing here is I'm going, okay, that looks like a nice flanking spot. There's no enemies up there, and I can probably take a look behind the house. So, again, you're encouraged to take things slowly, be very stealthy. Your suppressors just work. No one can hear you. As long as you're not running directly past someone and you choose not to be in their line of sight for more than a few minutes, you can just get away with stuff. So, what happens here? Yep. So this is the command menu. You've got different options there: fire, move to, regroup, and hold. It's very, very basic, and the AI is not great. I mean, I told them to regroup. Now they're still staying fairly separate. I think it's partly the idea that they're meant to be simulating co-op partners, of which you can have three, and they can do whatever they want later after this. And not in the video, but I tried some online with a friend and we managed to just wander about the map doing stuff. We didn't have to be in proximity at all. Now you're given the option to fast travel, like, but otherwise you can just explore. Now this is weather effects kicking off. So storms, fog, rain, all kinds of things. Now storms were actually quite fun in this. There's some really pretty, real, like, absolutely stunning looking water effects on people. Right, that right there is an example of how you can, in the game, scope out collectibles and objectives. So what that is, it's a weapon case. It has either a weapon or a weapon part. There is a stupid large amount of weapon parts and weapons to unlock, and it feels like they're going to be the majority of the thing that keeps you exploring in the game.
ID your targets. Amaru gets killed
so,
by a stray round.
Here we go, first proper mission where we're going to try and take things slowly and engage with things properly and be military and go the whole Taxim way. So we tell our squad to go to position.
Roger.
And then we try and work out, make sure they actually go there for a start, because I wasn't particularly trusting of the AI here.
Ready?
Wait for them to go to the patient, open fire, and then start picking off targets. So, as you can see, unlike something like a Division, you just shoot and things go down. Mostly. I mean, that man right there is wearing a t-shirt that has now taken four bullets. So, it's still not exactly realism. This isn't Arma. So as you can see, this is me working out that pistols are fine if you don't shoot a lot quickly. So take up positions, turn split. Windows are destructible, not a lot else is, fences, things like that. Most of this cover can't break. So I've gained skill point through experience, I think. You gain skill points through experience and all sorts of other stuff. So, kill an enemy, suppression works. And we come across our captive, but there's collectibles. So in the finest traditions of Ubisoft, I'm going to ignore the objective and just go and, you know, pick up all the things. All the highlighted things need to be picked up. It's a nice touch, you can shoot the locks. I quite liked it. It wasn't necessary, but
come on,
yeah.
We're getting you out of here.
So, as you can see, the dialogue is not particularly clever. That man's supposed to have been tortured for literal days, and the majority of what he said so far is just him being kind of pithy and witty. But he's limping a bit. He's holding his chest, so he's probably sad. Honestly, the story in this game is just kind of stupid, and it's not what the game is for. It's got a horrible undercurrent of current events, in that this is an American team going to deal with South American problems because they can and because they want to protect their borders from the nasty people. But it's not. They are pains to point out in the introductory video that this game has been in development for 5 years, which is fair. It's
sure are a lot
impressive.
Of light switches up here.
But it's not reflecting current events intentionally. So helicopters. There's a lot of aerial travel in this game. You're encouraged to steal helicopters for the rebels to get supplies, to use them for quick transport. You can also ride them, the way my AI partners are going.
Entonces Pacatari has made his deal with the malditos extranjeros, the young fool. Take it up with him, senor.
So yes, as you can see, they leave a little bit in Spanish there, to spare the blushes of our audience. But I can imagine that what he said was that he doesn't particularly approve of, you know, outside influences in his rebel cell. The rebels are so far characterized as bumbling, idiotic, completely incapable forces who are relying upon the nice Americans to come and rescue them. They make the point that these four Americans can do what several hundred rebels can't, which is probably true. I mean, the game is kind of built that way, but this is me testing the flying controls. It's very fluid. You can spin about quite nicely. The game doesn't particularly like the idea that you travel at high altitudes. It constantly encourages you to fly low, which is neat. This is a good way of showing off the draw distance as well, and to encourage you to pick out things on the ground. So here we go. Find our location. Do a nice, perfect landing. Definitely nothing goes wrong, and we don't bounce off some stuff. So yeah, it's the first proper mission, and that's kind of it. I mean, it's fine. The game is pretty good. I enjoy all the mechanics. Except that encounter is typical of every encounter in the game. There's nothing going on beyond that so far. There's a mission much later on where you take on the bosses of the area. I'll stop talking for a second so you can see the lovely dialogue that is very representative of what you're doing.
Let us see. Their talk of love was enough to make me vomit. But their methods were not.
Were their names Yuri and Polito?
Si. Yuri Polito.
These are the fucks that tortured Ricky Sandoval while Sueño questioned him. I want them bad.
We only saw run-of-the-mill Sicarios when we freed Amaru.
But I haven't seen Yuri and Polito in at least 3 days, maybe four. I don't know where they are now.
We need more intel.
We'll search every village and camp until we find something.
Somebody's gotta know something.
Gather documents, hack computers, interrogate hostile lieutenants, talk to civvies, whatever it takes.
We'll turn over every rock.
And that's your game. You go, you complete minor objectives to find out information. That unlocks the main bad guys, who are Yuri and Polito, who are a... Actually, they're the most interesting characters in this entire beta, because they're a couple who torture people and are hideously in love. It's very saccharine. So you get weapons for completing missions, you get various things and completing missions. So there's videos to watch that explain the backstory. You can ignore them. I did. I just wanted to see what happened in game. So the idea is that, in a similar way to something like Mercenaries, you explore, find minor targets, take them out, get information, go and get full, go and get the big targets. So the missions are, there's 10 Kingslayer files, finding all 10 gets you to 6. This is your upgrade tree. As you can see, you've got 5 different resources to keep track of, 4 types of supplies that you get from helping rebels, and skill points. You need a number of skill points and also a number of supplies to upgrade things. So I went, I need a parachute because I'm not good at not pressing the get out of helicopter button. So I decided to set that as my first one. I needed 2 skill points and a certain amount of supplies. And that's kind of how it works. Now you've got level gating to encourage you to level up and not just grind and spend points. And it's not, it's a good, it's a reasonable system. There's an epic skill for completing your tree, all that kind of thing. It's not, there's nothing very deep about it, especially the idea that you, at the end, you're going to be great. So 550 comms supplies will get me a parachute. And that was my aim, because I'm clumsy. So yeah, go through all that. There's also rebel support that you get by unlocking missions. This is something like mortar strikes and calling in diversions. Yeah, it's fine. It's not, it's nothing particularly special. It's so at any point you can join public co-op and call in friends. Well, it works out pretty well. So here we go, and off to the last mission. Now I decided to start with the helicopter, and then we move into a car and just kind of faff about for a bit, because I wanted to try going a bit louder on attacking somewhere, because I figured everywhere's probably gonna be full of bad guys. Let's go and make a mess and see how that goes. So as you can see, I've been playing as a very smartly dressed lady for most of this. There's a full character customizer. You've got a fairly reasonable range of characters and designs to choose from, and you can go the full run of civilian dressed contractor to proper ghillie suit military simulator when you're designing your character. And what you're seeing there is the witty banter of your team. As you can see, again, these are people you're going to come to love and respect through the game. And it's mostly about basically how they're badasses and great people and everyone else is kind of not. So this is an encounter with the police slash military forces online. So you've got, decided to just annoy them for a moment, see what happens. They are not overly dangerous. They do take me out a little bit later on because I can run directly at them. Don't do that. They've got armor. They are better trained, and there's more of them in theory than the bad guys. At any point, you can pick up enemy weapons. So they're basically police. They work. You raise your level of danger by annoying them, and they come after you. It's a good system in that while the rebels, well, not the rebels, sorry, the cartel hold areas, and you have to go and annoy them, the Unidad just wander about and get in your way. They do come as you get more and more dangerous around with helicopters and armored vehicles. Didn't see any tanks or anything like that. So yeah, when you go down, I totally did that on purpose so you could see what it looks like, just to make that clear. You go down and your teammates go and pick you up. They can do this once per fight, as the little tooltip over there says. And then you swear in... It's really weird. There's some really... They're not creative, but they're not traditional swearing when that happens. This is how you can see that the aiming is entirely different when you're scoped in or not. You get reasonable accuracy on hip fire, and scoped in is a lot better. So pick up weapons from enemies. Get away with stuff like that. It's not too bad. Just kind of gets on with it. So I decided to leave our helicopter behind and grab my teammates. If you do not have a vehicle that supports four teammates, they will just teleport. I didn't realize this for a very long time, so this is why you see me just kind of waiting around here. Now, combat from vehicles is hilarious looking, because everyone just hangs out the windows like a dog and starts shooting. It works thematically and it's fine. It's just like insane. So what you've got in the background there is the in-game radio, which is... It's, again, it's got this kind of dismissive bumpkin attitude for the populace, where everyone's a collaborator and they're talking about the most ridiculous, stupid things. Like, there's a part where they're talking about the leader of the cartel is working on a submersible for everyone, and he's going to make sure that everyone gets one, and it won't be detectable to the radar or sonar. Yeah, it's got that same feel as Mercenaries, where everything had that kind of black humor to it. Everything's got this edge where it should be funnier, but it feels like they're laughing at the game world as opposed to with the player, if that difference makes sense. The player is laughing at the joke because they should be laughing at these people, not laughing at the joke because it's actually funny. So coming up here, I decide, oh, that looks like there's bad guys in it. I should investigate. The little red markers there show there's danger, and then as you spot people, they become more accurate. And road kills work. It's kind of, the hitboxes are a bit busy. So another mission going on. Oh, over the guy over there, and we are shooting him. Done. Great. There we go.
You guys all good? Damn, I love this job.
There we go. It's very jingoistic in dialogue. Now, this is, I'm sounding kind of negative, but I actually really enjoyed playing this. It's the actual game in game-to-game moment, and the loop is very fun. It's a really straightforward. Find a scenario, decide how you want to approach it, engage, go with the mission, do what you want. And so you can go in guns blazing, like I'm about to do here, or you can scan and plan and get on with everything. The problem is that the game doesn't have any more than that. The only special mission I got was the one where we go and attack the area bosses, who are exactly as dangerous as anyone else. They die just like regular people. They just are in the middle of a bunker somewhere, torturing someone. So you're allowed to kind of investigate them, and they're given a little bit more characterization. So as you can see, we're just rolling about, ruining everything in this village.
Target down. Sniper,
and
get down.
The problem is there's very little to do. As you can see, as we're wandering through the village, we're marking things out and spotting things, and we're getting bits and pieces. Little things popping up, like the ammo box on the left there in the minimap, now it's on the right, and seeing vehicles. But there's no engagement. This is a shooting gallery. We go in, we clear the shooting gallery, and unless a mission tells us to come back here, we have no reason to ever come back here once we have found everything. It's one of the weirdly the excesses of Ubisoft design are entirely on display here. There is this massive open world And you blaze through it, just pilfering and collecting and not engaging. There's nothing here beyond little backstory parts that, while some of them are quite well written, later on you find out that this village was taken apart because it was actually harboring the guy we rescued earlier. So the cartel leader, who is a kind of horrific tattooed worst excesses of stereotypical Latino design religious fanatic, ends up going, okay, destroy the entire place. They know that he's there, so they're all traitors. Kill them. And they destroy the village, and that's why you can see the smoke coming out at the end there. So this is it. You can see that there's still a bad guy left. We hear the gunshots and also see the little orange flare on the minimap. So we know there's a person, we just haven't seen him, we just haven't found him yet. And we just finish clearing the village. Now, later on, I came back here to rescue a rebel who had been held captive, and I did the exact same thing, and nothing was different. The enemy didn't engage differently, didn't do anything. And the AI is not particularly clever. As you saw, I'm playing on the regular difficulty. Later on, it got bumped up to Ghost, and the enemies behaved in exactly the same way. The only difference was that I went down faster. They don't take cover that well, they just kind of wander about. They don't flank, they don't move. They just run at you and shoot. So there's very little challenge, and there's very little to engage with. And it's pretty, and the animations, when they're not clipping through walls or people, and are very neat. They're easily the rival of anything in the Division to show characterization and that kind of thing. The music's nice. The in-game car radio music's quite nice, even if the dialogue sections aren't. And you get lovely motifs like that where you're coming through this graveyard and there's crows flying around the destroyed village, and you're looking at this really quite serene environment. And here I decide to switch out weapons because I'm going to test out the sniper rifle, do stuff like that. And switching weapons is just very simple. You've got three on you at all times. You can carry anything you want. As you can see, there's a whole selection of weapons. Many of them are only unlocked when you engage with, or when you take out special bad guys. And you can't keep anything you pick up. It swaps out on death or on fast travel. So, yeah, we just have this. The entire game is built around little tiny engagements, and then vast stretches of nothing of interest. And once you're done with the engagements, there's very little else to do. So we've got this beautiful, really impressively big world. And imagine that's meant to have textures, it didn't bear that. So we come across this really, really pretty view. And I stop for a minute and I kind of think about it. It's nice, but there's nothing there. Like, there's a village off in the distance, but that village will be exactly the same as this one. They'll be bad guys, and I'll shoot them, and I'll do nothing else. Once the missions in this game are done, it feels like there's going to be very little to come back to. Thanks.